Yesterday I spoke to you on Hequin's songs of meditation. What is the difference between a Buddha and a person who is not yet Buddha? It is indeed the difference of awareness. A Buddha is aware every moment. Each one of his actions is guided by his awareness, whereas man is unconscious. He has not yet attained to awareness. He does something, then repents it. The song of Hequin is actually the song of meditation, the song of silence. All beings are Buddhas. This includes the human beings, the sentient and insentient. When we look at consciousness, it has seven levels or seven stories, or it can be said that man is a seven-storied consciousness, seven-storied structure. Each story represents a level of consciousness. If we draw a horizontal X and Y axis, the ordinates according to geometry will be 0, 0, the X axis coordinate. When you draw a line horizontal and vertical, where the lines intersect one another, that's where the ordinates are 0, 0. To the left, the X ordinate is negative. Below, Y axis, Y ordinate is negative. This is the geometry. As such, where man stands, it is the level of consciousness. The 0, 0 ordinate represents the consciousness. The one below this is the level of subconscious and unconscious. Then, when we talk about the human beings, there is unconsciousness. When there are a group of people, they are both unconscious. If you put it this way, you are ignorant, and your husband and wife is also ignorant. Then the ignorance will be collective ignorance. Collective ignorance, because you are ignorant, your husband, your wife is also ignorant, and this is collective. The two people or more than two people, when they are ignorant, it represents the collective ignorance or collective unconsciousness. It is a stronger collective unconsciousness, is greater in magnitude than the individual unconsciousness, because the other is not there to support you. For instance, if you are talking to a master and there is a streaks or spells of unconsciousness, the master being conscious, he can correct you. He can change your unconsciousness into consciousness. This is what happens when you come in the company of the master. But when all are unconscious, then the collective unconsciousness becomes greater. This is the situation of the crowd. Crowd is collective unconsciousness. Then there is cosmic unconsciousness. The unconsciousness, when it becomes the part of the cosmos, when we look at it, a particular community, the everyone in that is unconscious. So three layers, two below, collective conscious, the collective unconsciousness, cosmic unconsciousness, and unconsciousness. So first is unconsciousness, which is individual, collective unconsciousness, and then cosmic unconsciousness. Then you reach to the level of the ordinates, the x-axis, where the ordinates are 0, 0, where you are simply conscious, or the process of consciousness is beginning. Then above that is collective consciousness. When two intelligent people or wise people are together, it immediately happens that one supports the other. And this is where the great inventions and things like that take place. You are already conscious. Your actions are guided by spells of awareness, and the other is also aware. It becomes collective consciousness. It is helpful. Then there is cosmic consciousness. So consciousness, collective consciousness, and cosmic consciousness. So thus there are these seven layers. The journey of spirituality begins that your first individual unconsciousness begins to dissolve. Then collective unconsciousness dissolves because your consciousness is becoming so strong that it helps to dissolve the unconsciousness of the others. The dark corners of your house are being filled with light of awareness, light of consciousness. Maybe your love, maybe your understanding, all this becomes the light and changes first unconsciousness to consciousness, changes collective unconsciousness to consciousness, and then it becomes cosmic consciousness. When we look at other animals, in this state of unconsciousness, you are always leaning towards the negative. There may be rare moments of consciousness, but when you are becoming, as you grow into consciousness, you begin to make the choices. Because whenever any circumstance and situation comes, you can be happy or unhappy. It is your choice. You can be angry or not angry. But when you are under the spell of unconsciousness or collective unconsciousness, then you will always choose to be angry. And then you will remain angry for a longer period of time. As the spells of consciousness begin to come into you, first it will happen, the gap between your anger and disappearance of anger will begin to reduce. Then it will happen just before the, at the very precise moment when anger is trying to breed into you, the consciousness comes and you realize that we are all one. We are all one human being, one consciousness. You realize something, you may remember the words of Buddha, it dawns on your mental horizon. All that you put into the lives of others comes back into you on its own, for the simple reason that the other is not other as you think. No man is island. We are all joined together. The moment these words comes, All that you put into the lives of others comes back into your own. Immediately, a change begins. You cannot choose to harm the other. You will remember whatever harm you are causing to the other. It will come back to you in many folds. Immediately, the process begins of transformation. This is the case with the human beings. You have a choice to be happy or unhappy, to choose this or that. You have a choice to go beyond the duality or remain within the spell of duality. Then there are others, sentient and insentient beings, like plants, the rivers, the animals, and all others. A plant is one composite. It is in a state of subconscious. Means the mind is not yet developed. It lives in total harmony with all that is and all that is happening. A rose continues to blossom amidst thorns. And then there is no disharmony between the thorn and the flowers. There may be a subconscious understanding in the plant that both thorns and the flowers, both thorns and flowers grow on the same stem. They draw their nourishment from the same earth. They draw their light from the same sun. Then how can there be a disharmony? How can a thorn be against the flower? Thorn is there to protect the flower. Thorn is there to protect the flower. And the flower is the beauty of the thorns. This is happening unconsciously. The plant, the rose flower, is not aware of this. This is a state of subconscious. Man has grown out of this state and he is in a state of unconsciousness. Two people are quarreling with one another in one room, not realizing that they are sitting on the same couch or sitting on different chairs of the same set of couch, reading something in the incandescence of the same bulb, drawing the cool breeze from the same air conditioned, sharing the same center table, yet still are in total disharmony with one another, total disagreement with one another. They are breathing one another. Whatever air you exhale becomes the part of the cosmos within the room, and the other inhales that air. And yet still there is so much disharmony, so much disagreement on the subject matter. This is the freedom, this is the choice of an individual. This gives a great impetus when the two views are put together in a state of understanding that the goal, the cause is common. The improvement of the company that you are working, There is no ego in between that my views should be heard and should be put into place in its totality, not that of the other. Both are working on one principle, one objective. Then you can go beyond the disharmony. Then the argument becomes constructive. Such is the choice that man has. Out of this choice, one day, unconsciousness can vanish completely. We realize one day that we are all part of one synergistic harmony. And then you remember the scriptural injunction, Ishavasyamidam sarvam yatkinch jagatyan jagat ten tyaktin bhunjitha magradha kashyashvitanam. Isha, which refers to consciousness, permeates the entire cosmos. If you are in harmony with it, you can enjoy the fruits of it. And what are the fruits of consciousness? Blissfulness, harmony, and oneness. Then the journey begins. The process of meditation begins. Then you come to realize the benediction of the existence. Hequin's song of meditation is indeed a song, as he calls it. If meditation is without song, dance, a celebration, it is dull and dead. It does not beat, it does not breathe. Meditation is a song, a dance. Sing it, dance it, enjoy every moment, whatever happens. That is meditativeness. Why this is happening? The dogs are guided by their own instincts, and the dogs do not know that we are meditating. Yet still we continue to get angry that I am meditating, and you use beautiful language. I am meditating and these blasted dogs don't understand. They continue to bark. Meditation has not happened to you. Meditation indeed is a song and a dance. Sing it and dance it. Just don't think upon it. And when you think upon meditation, you start thinking of meditation as a thought or idea, you will miss the message, you will miss its content. You will find the song of Hequin and its meaning only when you are singing and dancing, when music of life has overtaken you, when it has possessed you, you know the essence. The song is so small and yet so vast, it is unbelievable. How can a man condense so much truth and so much love and insight in just few words? But Hequin was a man of few words, instead a man of total silence. For years he did not speak. He did not speak at all. And later, when he spoke only a word or two. I have heard once the king of Japan invited him to deliver a sermon in his palace. The queen, the king, the prime minister, the ministers, and all the high officials and generals, all were invited, and they gathered with respect to listen to Hequin. Hequin came. He stood there for a single moment, looked around and left the hall. The king was puzzled. He asked his prime minister, "What is the matter with this man? We had come to listen, the old prime minister, who was a disciple of Heckman, said, "This is the greatest sermon that I have just heard." He has said it. You have asked him to come to and teach you about silence, because meditation is silence. And he has taught it. He stood there in silence. He was silence. Silence was overflowing. What more do you ask for? What more do you demand to know about meditation? He was pure silence, standing there for those few seconds. Utter silence, the singing and the dancing silence, the overflowing silence. He was silence, throbbing, pulsating, singing and dancing. But you were interested in hearing something. Nothing can be said about silence. It is unseen but realized truth. You have to feel the silence deep within the recess of your inner sanctum. When all the noise disappears, all of a sudden a silence descends. You can capture this silence through an unheard sound, or this is actually the unheard sound when all the noise disappears. You are breathing. There is a sound. But because of the clutter of the mind, because of the constant words that are overflowing, you are not able to hear this heartbeat. You are not able to hear the breathing. The moment all the noise disappears, if you hear in the wilderness, the birds are chirping. Now and then there is the sound of the birds chirping when there is silence. The cricket noise, the humming of the bees, all these are there. So when all the clatter of the mind suddenly disappears, you hear the birds chirping. But when there is a noise, you want to hear something, you want to say something. I am not interested in saying something. I am here just to give you the taste of the silence, the taste of your heartbeat, the taste of your own being. This is what the meditation is all about. That is why it is a singing and dancing song. Sing it, dance it in its totality. You will be transformed. About silence, nothing can be said. All that can be said about silence will be wrong, because it is unseen, unheard, yet a realization, yet an experience that there is silence all around. How can you say something about silence? Because to say something will be falsified. To say something, you have to use the words. That is why Lao Tzu says that nothing can be said about Tao. And if something is said, in the very saying of it, it becomes untrue. You ask me a glass of water. If I say something, that existential glass of water that has the capacity to quench your thirst is no more. A word is meaningless. The word glass of water is meaningless. If I write on a piece of paper glass of water and give it to you, this is philosophy. This is not existential. Silence is overflowing existential. It cannot be put into the words. Tao is silent, but that silence is not the silence of a cemetery. Instead, it is the silence of the garden where trees are alive, breathing. Yet there is utter silence. There is ecstasy, there is joy, there is blossoming, there is unity in diversity. There is unity in diversity. On a green tree, a red flower, a yellow flower, a white flower blossoms, enhancing the beauty of the garden. It is a dancing and overflowing silence. It is not dead silence, it is alive. Hence, Hequin calls it the song of meditation. Song of meditation. This is the approach of the Buddhas. The approach not that of belief, instead the approach of seeing. It is not the religion of the philosophers, instead the religion that come and see. Not come and believe. Buddha says, come and see. Ihi pasika. It is here, present. Just you have to develop the eyes, come and see. He does not require, Buddhas do not require for you to believe anything. Buddhas do not require you to believe anything. Instead, Buddhas do not want you to believe anything. Instead, their whole emphasis is dropping all belief systems. Come and see. And when you come and see, then all the belief system begins to drop and you are transformed. You are transformed from a very childish stature to a mature being. With the religion of Buddhas, with the religion of understanding, you attain to your youthfulness, yet maturity. Otherwise, you will grow physically, yet still there will be childishness, yet still there will be immature. With the ways of Buddha, you attain to your youthfulness, your childlike innocence, beyond beliefs. Indeed, belief is superstition. Belief is out of fear, and belief is blind. Buddha gives eyes to the religion. He says, come and see. There is no need to believe. And when you have seen, you have known, then how can there be a belief? Instead, it will be knowing. The religion, the way of Buddhas, gives you the youthfulness, the understanding, awareness, and maturity. Maturity comes with understanding. Maturity comes with awareness. Maturity comes with meditation, not with age. Physically you can grow, you can attain to maturity, but that does not mean that you have spiritual maturity. That comes with meditation, that comes with understanding. This is why Hequin calls it the song of meditation. Only this much for this morning.